Stop using tools like Beautiful Soup, Selenium, and Scrapy. Let's face it, they're slow, it's tedious to work with, and you might actually be missing out on some key information you could otherwise web scrape. Wouldn't it be nice to extract just the information we wanted from websites rather than having to sort through all the HTML, which can be very slow and just very tedious to look through? Good news, because there's actually a technique called forging API requests, which allows to do exactly this. It has advantages over traditional HTML web scraping, such as it's usually easier to scrape at scale if you do it correctly. It sometimes returns extra information not even visible in the HTML of the website, and it's in a human readable format, and there's a ton of other advantages. By the end of this video, you'll be extracting data from a website by forging API requests. But first, to do this, we have to understand how data gets sent to a website. There are two main ways that this is accomplished. The first one is called server-side rendering, in which all required data for the client, typically a website, is passed as a part of the HTML to the client itself. A consequence of this is when the client needs more data, it typically requires a page refresh, as all the data must be sent again as an HTML file. The second of which is called AJAX. In AJAX, the client is responsible for fetching the data from the server every time it needs new data. For example, if the client is refreshing a feed, such as scrolling up on Instagram, and it wants the latest posts, it just makes an HTTP request to get that data directly. It doesn't return any extra HTML or anything like that. It just returns the data that's needed. After the client has the data, it can render those posts as HTML or do anything else it wants with it. Since the requests are done in the browser, we can see these requests that it's making. So, how do we exploit this to get only the data we want? The answer is we have to first go into our browser and find the requests that we do want returned. Then we can make a program that looks like a client and sends these requests to the server so that the server can't tell the difference between a real user and our program. That way, the server has to return the data to us, because otherwise it would result to users not being able to access the data from the client, which is a bad user experience. This idea is called API request forging, which you extract data by pretending to be a legitimate client when you're not. There are some disadvantages to forging API requests, though. One of which is sometimes websites will update their APIs so frequently that it's really hard to make sure your program looks exactly like a real client. The second of which, it can be hard to emulate human behavior, especially like with CAPTCHAs and all that. But we're going to cover that later in this series, so don't worry about that for now. Let's jump into the example for this video. This video is actually part of a free YouTube course that I've been making that has mock websites, test suites, and a ton of other stuff. So make sure to download those files if you want to follow along after this, and be sure to give it a subscribe.
First step is actually getting the website running. To do this, run Docker Compose up in the lesson directory. After a while, it'll stop printing messages and you can visit localhost:3000 in your browser, and hopefully you see this. Let's quickly take a look at the description of the first function, extract feed in activity.py. It tells us to return post objects from the feed page. To forge an API request that returns this data, we have to understand how the website gets its data. To do this, look in the network tab of the developer tools in the browser. Then scroll down until a new page is fetched, and you should see the request in the browser. If we open this URL by double-clicking on the request, it returns the data, and if we give it a large value, it returns a blank array, meaning that there are no more posts. We can use this new understanding of the client to write a Python script to emulate the client. To make an HTTP request, I'm going to be using the request package, but anything else should work. Then I'm going to initialize and return an array called posts. I'll set the initial page to be 0, as we saw the API was 0 indexed, as we learned this from the website. Next, I'll use a while loop to make requests for the feed, passing in the page variable and incrementing it after the request. I'll extract the new post for that particular page by converting the response to a dictionary and using the posts key. Then, if no pages are returned, then I know that we've seen all of the posts, so I'll break the while loop. Otherwise, I'll add the new posts on this particular page to the posts array. Extract emails is really similar to extract feed. It wants us to return an array of all the emails from the discover page. If you go to the discover page, you can see the API request, which is then reproducible in Python. I've reused most of this code from the extract feed method, so I'm not covering it in detail. The only difference is you have to add the email field of profile to the emails array. The username exists function asks us to return true if a username does exist, and false if it doesn't. If we navigate back to the feed page and click on the username, it brings us to a profile page. To test what happens when the username is invalid, I typed in some random letters and the website told me that it doesn't exist. So I checked the network tab and found the URL to make a request to, and it had a field called error that has a value of user does not exist if the user does not exist. Back in Python, we first make a request to the URL that we found and parse the JSON response. This says if the response has an error key, then we use the value from that. Otherwise, we use a blank string and we compare this to the user does not exist. If true, this means the server is saying that the user does not exist, so we return false. Otherwise, the user does exist and we return true. Congrats on finishing lesson one. Creating these two lessons took me over 40 hours, so please subscribe, it helps out a lot. If you want to interact with TikTok Live from Python, click here, or check out the course playlist here.